សូមអញ្ជើញគុជអង្គជំរះប្រកាសបន្តនីតិវិធីសមនការដេញដោលតរទៀតហើយជាកិច្ចបន្តនេះសូមជូនវេទិកាទៅតំណាងសហប្រជាជាតិដើម្បីបន្តការសួរដេញដោលដល់អ្នកជំនាញ
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. Chanda, we were talking about
Chanda,
the age-old enmity and the sources for that. I'd like to ask you, please, for a Vietnamese source which made reference to who made reference to the enmity between the two parties. This comes from your meeting in March of 1978 with the Vietnam Vice Foreign Minister. You've mentioned this already, Mr. Vo Dong Giang. And you refer to this in your book at page 60, evidence reference number 00192245. And the paragraph at the top of the page, page 60, Mr. Giang talks to you about the conflict going back over two decades. I wonder if you could perhaps shed a little more light on that conversation, how it came about, and to perhaps illustrate a little more fully what the Vice Foreign Minister was talking about when he referred to the conflict going back over two decades.
This meeting with the Vice Foreign Minister Vo Dong Giang was extraordinary, because in my reporting of Vietnam all these years, this was the first time that Vietnamese Foreign Ministry took a proactive step in inviting three foreign journalists to a private dinner with the Deputy Foreign Minister to explain the long historical context of the conflict. This is an unusual background briefing. At the time, we were not allowed to use his name, so when I reported this conversation to the Palestinian Economic Review, I said to senior Vietnamese official,
Mr.
Giang essentially says what I have referred to in the past,
the Khmer
resistance to the idea of
Indochina
unity. Vietnamese maintain that there was no desire to form an Indochina Federation. It was a bogey that was used by Vietnam's enemies. What Vietnam was looking for was close cooperation between the three independent states of Indochina in order to foil all the plots against socialism in that part of the world. So, going back, he mentioned the Geneva conference in which the Cambodian side felt abandoned because they were not given a seat at the table, and Geneva conference basically legitimized the rule of Prince Sihanouk over whole of Cambodia. There was not one part of Cambodia that was given to the resistance forces. And then throughout the 70s and 60s, when Vietnam was advising the Khmer Rouge not to take the part of the rebellion against Prince Sihanouk, because Sihanouk was an objective ally because he was supporting the revolution by allowing Vietnamese to transit arms to their liberated areas through Cambodia
from the Sihanouk Hill port to Vietnam border.
And so it was for the sake of
overall revolution in Indochina, it was important
for the Cambodians
also cooperated with Khmer
at the period. And then when Sihanouk was overthrown, then Vietnamese had no obligation to support Long Nol.
Vietnam
and hence, they actually threw their support behind the Khmer Rouge fully and took part in the military campaign against Long Nol forces in
71.
But then, once Vietnam started negotiations with the Americans on ending the war, again the situation like Geneva occurred because the Khmer Rouge felt that they didn't want to negotiate. They wanted a victory completely on their own, and they accused the Vietnamese of abandoning them and allowing American Air Force to Cambodia.
Vietnam,
but despite that, even before the capture of Phnom Penh in 1975, Vietnamese provided arms and training to the Khmer Rouge, which enabled them to actually capture Phnom Penh in 1975.
So,
John's position was that we have made tactical difference with the Khmer Rouge, but we strategically we supported them.
And
example was that Vietnamese did support them in 75
operation.
But since then, the Khmer Rouge had turned against Vietnam.
And
the suggestion was that this was an anti-Vietnamese plot backing from China. And so that was the main thrust of his briefing.
Thank you.
I wonder if you can tell us the names of the two other journalists who accompanied you to the dinner.
One was Roland Pierre Carango.
Is it possible to spell his name?
R-O-L-A-N-D hyphen P-I-E-R-R-E P-A-R-I-N-G-A-U-X. And the other journalist was from Dutch newspaper,
Handelsblatt,
H-A-N-D-E-L-S-B-L-A-T. And his name was Karel, K-A-R-E-L, Van, V-A-N,
Karel Van,
W-O-L-F-E-R-E-N.
Thank you.
I'd like to move on to a source that you cited in your book when you described the Cambodian attacks, the Khmer Rouge attacks on Koh Tral or Phu Quoc in Vietnamese on May the 4th, 1975. In your book, I think this is a footnote annotating page 13, ER00191928. You describe the source for the attack on Phu Quoc and Koh Krachakses Island to be a personal communication with an Australian Foreign Service officer who, on the 5th of April 1979 in Malaysia, had interviewed a particular South Vietnamese soldier who had lost his whole family of 12 in the original Khmer Rouge attack. And I think you say that's in relation to the Koh Krachakses Island. Could you confirm the source you used? And do you have any comments on it specifically?
Yes, indeed. It was an Australian Foreign Service officer.
This was
a conversation I had with his experience in interviewing
some of the refugees and
he had no particular reason to invent that story.
And I thought that story
fitted with what I knew, so that's why I
invented the story.
In general terms, in your book, there appears to be a lull in the fighting in 1976, or a lull in armed incidents between Vietnam, committed either by Vietnam or Cambodia. And you were asked whether you had seen any telegraphs, internal telegraphs. Her Honour Judge Cartwright asked you about that. Can I ask you the same question in relation to whether you had seen any internal military reports that you have seen, any internal Khmer Rouge military reports from the border area back to the party center in Phnom Penh?
I do not recall seeing it, and I have seen it in the book.
Given the history of the conflict that you have outlined in detail in your book and you described for us in evidence, would it have struck you, or does it strike you, as unusual or likely or not, that there may have been armed incidents in 1976 committed either by Cambodia
or Vietnam, the fact of Pol Pot changing the date of the party and certain veteran members who are more in favor of keeping the date of the party, 1951. In other words, they were seen as close to Vietnamese thinking. Those are the people who are sent to S21. And given the fact that there was a turmoil going on inside Cambodia, regarding the new orientation of the party, I'd be surprised if there are some clashes as well on the board.
Just a little clarification. I referred to military reports, internal military reports, and Her Honour Judge Cartwright referred to telegrams. If you were writing your book today, would you avail yourselves of those sources if you were able to consider
them? Absolutely.
This might be an obvious question, but why would you use such sources?
Because if the source is first of all, it's credible that I am convinced that indeed was an internal document, and the date was accurate
and the
person who was sending
it
was someone in the position of authority to do so. It would be very important part of evidence to show how the conflict was developing in the border.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm moving on to 1977
now.
And in your book, you describe how at page 87 of your book, I'm sorry, the RN00192272, at page 87, you describe how Khmer Rouge forces had been raiding Vietnam's border provinces since quote, January 1977. Are you able to tell us what sources you used for the date as early as January 77? And if so, could you tell us?
I do not recall exactly how I came to that date, January 77, but I suspect that because I interviewed a lot of people along the border in during my trip in March 1978, I had asked people about their history and where they moved and what happened. So it's quite possible that it was from such interviews that I realized that there was some attack in January 77.
I've asked you about sources from, can I say, important people in the region. In relation to the ordinary people on the ground, the people who may have been directly affected by the incidents along the border, can you help us please with what sort of interviews you conducted, how many there may have been, and whether you cited
This was one of the most important part of my reporting is to actually give the government mindless sleep and try to talk to people directly. And when I could speak directly or have an interpreter, but who was not necessarily associated with the government. So I tried to talk to people independently in all locations I had an opportunity to talk to them. And I may have used only a few anecdotes just to provide some color and human interest in the otherwise high political discourse. So by no means I used all the interviews. But these interviews are provided a kind of very rich background carpet which I could place the other major political events that were happening. So,
the interrelationship between individuals and much larger forces
operating beyond that person's reach is something that personally I was very interested in finding out. And so, I did interview quite a few people.
Forgive me for seeking clarification of the general term, quite a few people, and I appreciate you may not be able to be specific, but can you give us an example, an estimate of how many people, ordinary people, you may have interviewed?
I would say
in visiting a camp, say,
in Tainin,
or Hatien. Depending on the time one has at one's disposal, and depending the time it takes to interpret, seek out details,
follow up questions,
I would say in any of these sort of visits, I would interview perhaps 6, 7, 8 people. That would be maximum given the time constraint.
So again,
I made so many visits, it's difficult to remember.
Thank you. At the same page from which we've just quoted, page 87, you refer to, in March 77, the Khmer Rouge army units in the eastern regions were, and I'm quoting you, taken off their production duty to be combat ready. I can hear a phone. I wonder if somebody could turn it off. The quote that I cite from you is that in March 1977, Democratic Cambodia Army units were taken off their production duty to be combat ready. Can you help us please with your sources for that particular assertion?
On page
87,
the second line of page 87, the third line of page 87
from the top.
I have no clear memory as to the source, but it can be either in Radio Phnom Penh broadcast, and that is most likely, given the language I used, it was most likely a Radio Phnom Penh broadcast saying that this is what is happening. But it could also be Cambodian refugees who I interviewed
in Vietnam.
Can I move on to the description of the Hungarian journalist, Mr. Sándor Gyuri, and I apologize if I pronounce his name incorrectly. I can spell it S-A-N-D-O-R, new word, G-Y-O-R-I.
And
the Hungarian journalist has been discussed but not yet named previously in your evidence. You discuss this at pages 192 through 194. And I wonder if you can perhaps tell us a little more of the story of Mr. Gyuri. First of all, confirm the source from which you heard this story. And secondly, perhaps talk about the invitation that Mr. Gyuri received. What happened to his notes and his papers, and whether they were eventually returned. If it is still fresh in your memory, or if not, refer to your book. Thank you.
I certainly remember very well. Sándor was
the president. Monsieur le président, pardonnez-moi. Monsieur le Président, pardonnez-moi d'interrompre mon confrère. mais je suis en train de perdre patience. Nous sommes en train d'assister à un exercice extrêmement professionnel de ce que l'on appelle en common law une examination ou bien une contre-examination. Je félicite mon confrère pour cet excellent exercice. Mais je ne suis pas, pour ma part, disposé à continuer pendant des semaines et des mois dans ce type de procédure. Et je souhaiterais que la Chambre se prononce sur ce que nous attendons des questions que les parties peuvent poser. Je rappelle que nous sommes dans une procédure de civil law. La Chambre a déjà posé de très nombreuses questions à l'expert et mon collègue n'a pas manqué dans ces questions de rappeler que plusieurs de ces questions ont déjà été évoquées ce matin. Mais avec le professionnalisme qui le caractérise, il veut aller plus loin, toujours plus loin, comme un excellent exercice de common law où tout doit être prouvé. Et c'est pour ça que je me suis levé maintenant pour la énième fois, on demande à monsieur l'expert de prouver quelle est sa source. Pour ma part, ça m'est totalement égal de savoir que monsieur Kyosampa n'a pas voulu déjeuner avec telle personne. Quand j'ai un expert de la qualité de monsieur que nous avons ici, je n'ai pas besoin de justifier de la totalité de ses sources. Ce à quoi nous sommes en train d'assister, c'est un double détournement de procédure. Et je me permets d'attirer l'attention de la Chambre. J'ai toujours dit que je souhaitais que dans nos juridictions internationales, on prenne le meilleur des deux systèmes de common law et de civil law. Mais aujourd'hui, ici, nous sommes en train de prendre le pire des deux systèmes. C'est-à-dire qu'il y a eu un interrogatoire extrêmement détaillé par la Chambre, civil law, et maintenant, nous sommes en train d'assister à un interrogatoire extrêmement détaillé par le procureur, common law. Et je vous promets que si nous continuons ainsi, nous sommes encore en audience l'année prochaine. Si pour chaque expert qui compte, on doit passer des heures à vérifier quelles étaient ses sources, nous sommes encore là l'année prochaine. Or, je rappelle une fois encore qu'il y a eu plus d'une année d'instruction. J'aimerais que les coprocureurs qui ont participé à cette instruction soient ramenés à cette procédure. Ou bien, elle n'a servi à rien, disons-le publiquement. Pourquoi toutes les questions évoquées aujourd'hui n'ont-elles pas été posées pendant l'instruction? Depuis ce matin, je n'ai pas entendu une seule référence à la procédure d'instruction. Est-ce que ça veut dire que nous avons définitivement abandonné l'idée qu'il y a eu une année d'instruction? J'aimerais donc, sur ce premier point, que la Chambre puisse décider si oui ou non nous allons continuer pour chaque témoin avec des examinations, cross-examination, c'est-à-dire avec une procédure typiquement common law qui a parfaitement son intérêt et sa logique quand il n'y a pas eu de procédure d'instruction et quand les juges de la Chambre ne posent pas eux-mêmes des questions aux témoins. Mais aujourd'hui, cette procédure de common law n'a rien à apporter de plus à la manifestation de la vérité. Deuxième détournement de procédure. Je comprends parfaitement, à travers les questions posées par les coprocureurs, que ce qui est recherché à l'instant, c'est d'accumuler des preuves pour le dossier numéro 2. On a parlé de M. Kyosampan. On a parlé plusieurs fois de M. Yangsari. Que je sache, ces deux personnes sont en prison à quelques mètres d'ici. Elles ne sont pas dans le box des accusés. Je dis qu'il n'est pas correct de vouloir acter aujourd'hui des preuves contre des personnes qui ne sont pas là. Et je ne vois pas comment nous, ici, qui sommes juristes, nous pouvons accepter ce détournement de procédure. Nous sommes là pour des faits dont Doux est accusé pour S21, il y a bien longtemps que je n'ai pas entendu parler de S21 aujourd'hui, sauf une toute petite allusion il y a quelques minutes. Voilà, Monsieur le Président, les observations que je voulais faire. Je fais observer très respectueusement à la Chambre que si nous continuons à ce rythme, demain, les parties civiles vont poser leurs questions à l'expert sur le même mode, et quand sonnera la pendule demain à 4h15, la défense n'aura pas eu la possibilité de poser une seule question. Si c'est ça que nous voulons, dites-le et nous partons.
Merci.
Thank you, Mr. President. If we add up the number of times the defense has spent objecting to questions, to evidence, and to submissions made on behalf of the co-prosecutors or the civil parties, we would see that we are wasting time with these sorts of objections. The objection is baseless and contains a number of allegations that I will not respond to. They do not deserve the dignity of a response. But as I discussed last week, we are here in the court to hear evidence publicly. I remind Maître Roux, as well as Your Honours, that Mr. Chanda did not have the opportunity of being heard as a witness in the investigating judge phase. There is no lengthy written interview of Mr. Chanda. He's not been spoken to in the same way as a witness would be
in other tribunals as an expert witness would be in other tribunals. The co-prosecutors are seeking to establish Mr. Chanda's expertise, which was the purpose of the series of questions I asked at the beginning, and also designed to express Mr. Chanda's knowledge of the policies of the two countries in question. This is the nature of the questions that the co-prosecutors have been asking. Such interruptions themselves are a waste of time. I choose my questions carefully, and I do not ask this experienced witness about every single source that he mentions.
But
the reason why we ask about particular sources is to demonstrate the policy and the reasons behind the policy, regardless of admissions that have been made by the accused. And I note that the accused does not wish to take a position before the 31st of December 1977. The co-prosecutors still bear the burden of proving the case against the accused. I note the time that we have with Mr. Chanda. I note we have 2 days. I have some more questions to ask him. And I had hoped, had it not been for any objections, to have concluded my questioning by the end of this afternoon. But regrettably, that now cannot take place. I invite the trial chamber to rule that this objection is irrelevant and baseless.
ធ្វើការស្នើដល់អង្គសហនការថាការជំទាស់របស់គាត់នោះគឺគ្មានអ្វីពាក់ព័ន្ធហើយមិនមានមូលដ្ឋានសំអាងឡើយបាទមេធាវីតំណាងដើមនៅនេះមានអ្វីចង់គាត់សម្គាល់លើការជំទាស់របស់មេធាវីការពារក្តីអំពីបញ្ហានៃការតាំងសំណួររបស់សហប្រញ្ញាដែរទីមិនមានធំជើញ
Jonas, thank you. I will take 10 seconds of your time. Just to put on the record that we do support the co-prosecutor's position, and I would like to put on the record that as matters stand now, if that can help your determination, my group has one question for this expert, which with the answer should take 2 minutes. That's what we have for this expert. If that can help your determination, I'm grateful.
Thank you, Mr. President. First, I have noted that the defense repeats again and again fundamental views on international proceedings and the role of civil law, relationship between civil and common law. I think everybody has noted these observations and they need not to be repeated again. It is a first preliminary remark. Due to the fact that the chamber has put questions to the expert does not mean that the parties are not allowed or are limited in their right to ask questions. And that is really not the nature of civil law. Of course, and to prove the case or to support the prosecution from the perspective of the civil parties, the parties are allowed to ask questions, of course, if they are not repetitious. Which was not the case so far by the questions that the prosecutors have put to witness. And the issue I would like to remind that the issue that we are talking about is armed conflict. And of course, regarding to this issue, it is not S-21 to which the questions should be limited. And of course, leaders and their role and their decisions and their positions play a role to consider if here an armed conflict took place between 75 and 79. So that I request the chamber to reject the objection
Monsieur le Président, si vous permettez, à titre indicatif, compte tenu de l'état des questions qui ont été posées dans ce débat aujourd'hui, tant par la Chambre que les coprocureurs, je pense que le groupe numéro 3 n'aura probablement pas de questions spécifiques à poser. Ceci pour vous permettre d'organiser le débat. Je vous remercie.
Je vous remercie. Je vous remercie. Je vous remercie. Je vous remercie.
Je vous
remercie. Je vous remercie. Je លោកស្រីលោកចៅក្រុមអង្គជំនុំជម្រះទីក្រុមក្នុងនាមខ្ញុំបាទជាមេធាវីដើមមិនដឹងរដ្ឋមន្ត្រីក្រមបួនមានការកត់សម្គាល់តែបន្តិចទេហើយក៏មិនជាមានសំណួរជាច្រើនទៅសួរទៅលើលោកនាយានចន្ទដាផងដែរក៏ប៉ុន្តែការកត់សម្គាល់របស់ខ្ញុំបាទនៅពេលនេះអ្វីដែលជាការជំទាស់របស់លោកមេធាវីការពារមិនចង់ឲ្យមានការសួរច្រើន ឬលោកគិតថាជាការអូសបន្លាយពេលវេលារាប់ខែរាប់ឆ្នាំនោះខ្ញុំបាទយល់ឃើញថាមិនដូច្នោះទេដែលហេតុថាលោកនាយ័នចន្ទដាជាអ្នកជំនាញមួយស្ទើរតែយើងរាប់ចូលថាជាជំនាញដែលគាត់ត្រាទុកជាប្រវត្តិសាស្ត្រនៃប្រទេសកម្ពុជាប្រទេសវៀតណាមនិងទំនាក់ទំនងរវាងបណ្ដាប្រទេសផ្សេងៗទៀតដែលនាំឲ្យកើតមានសង្គ្រាមរវាងកម្ពុជានិងវៀតណាម ដូច្នេះតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំបាទនឹងការសំណូមពររបស់ខ្ញុំបាទខ្ញុំបាទសូមឲ្យមានការសាកសួរលោកពលិញ្ញាមេធាវីដើមមិនដឹងរត់ទៅវិញនេះនិងលោកមេធាវីការពារដូចគ្នាដែរប៉ុន្តែពេលយើងក៏មានកំណត់ត្រឹមពីថ្ងៃប៉ុណ្ណោះខ្ញុំក៏មានការសោកស្ដាយណាស់ដែរប៉ុន្តែអ្វីដែលយើងខ្ញុំចង់បានគឺប្រជាពលរដ្ឋនិងមតិមហាជនក្នុងប្រទេសនិងក្រៅប្រទេសចង់ដឹងចង់លឺណាស់ ហេតុផលអ្វីដែលនាំឲ្យប្រទេសកម្ពុជាធ្វើសង្គ្រាមរវាងគ្នានឹងគ្នាដែលក្នុងសិភៅលោកសរសេរថាសត្រូវជាបងប្អូនឯងនោះអញ្ចឹងខ្ញុំបាទយល់ថាលោកនាយកចន្ទដាជាអ្នកជំនាញថ្ងៃនេះលោកអាចបំភ្លឺរាល់សំណួរទាំងឡាយដែលយើងខ្ញុំក៏ចង់បានប្រជាពលរដ្ឋខ្មែរទូទាំងប្រទេសនិងបណ្ដាប្រជាពលរដ្ឋលើពិភពលោកចង់ឮថ្ងៃនេះដូចគ្នាអញ្ចឹងហើយខ្ញុំបាទយល់ថាមិនមែនជាការខាតប្រយោជន៍ណាស់ណានោះទេ អញ្ចឹងគ្រាន់តែថាបើលោកមេធាវីការពារយល់ថាសំណួរណាដែលជាន់គ្នានោះលោកប្រធានដឹកនាំសាវនាការនិងហាមឃាត់រួចទៅហើយអញ្ចឹងទោះបីខាងនីតិវិធីស៊ីវិលឬខមមិនឡមានការហាមឃាត់ឬខកចំទាស់យ៉ាងណាក៏ដោយនេះជាសិទ្ធិឬក៏កាតព្វកិច្ចរបស់មេធាវីការពារទេតែខ្ញុំបាទសំណូមពរសូមឲ្យមានការអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យមានការសួរឲ្យបានច្បាស់លាស់និងឲ្យលោកនាយ័នចន្ទដាមានប្រសាសន៍
រៀបរាប់ឲ្យបានកាន់តែភ្លឺកាន់តែច្បាស់ថែមជាងនេះទៀតខ្ញុំបាទសូមគាំទ្រការសាកសួររបស់លោកពលិញ្ញាបាទសូមអរគុណសូមអនុញ្ញាតទៀតសូមអញ្ជើញលោកមេធាវីសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានហើយសូមអរគុណអង្គជំនុំជម្រះខ្ញុំបាទក៏សម្គាល់ដល់ឃើញថាលោកមេធាវីការពារក៏ ខំប្រឹងប្រែងការពារកូនក្តីរបស់គាត់នឹងគឺថាជាការសំរុំហើយខំប្រឹងអញ្ចឹងក៏ប៉ុន្តែគាត់បានលើកឡើងពីចំណុចថានេះគឺជានីតិវិធីដែលប្រើនៅស៊ីវិលឡមិនមែន common law ទេអញ្ចឹង
ហើយយើងប្រើនេះតទៅនឹងកំមុនលហើយគឺថាច្បាប់ការនីតិវិធីនេះប៉ុន្តែគាត់អត់មានមូលដ្ឋានឯច្បាស់លាស់ទេតាំងពីមិនថាពីព្រឹកគឺតាំងពីដើមសវនាការថ្ងៃទី30ខែមីនាមកម្លេះគឺថាយើងបានប្រើថាស៊ីវិលឡក្នុងការសួរ សំណួរទៅដល់ភាគីនឹងសាកសួរទាំងអស់តែបើសិនតែជាប្រព័ន្ធខមមុនឡវិញគឺថាចៅក្រមអត់មានមិនធ្វើការមិនតាំងសំណួរទេគឺថាចៅក្រមទាំងអស់នៅតែស្ងៀមទុកឲ្យភាគីទាំងអស់គឺគេសួរដេញដោលនេះគឺជាប្រព័ន្ធខមមុនឡអញ្ចឹងការប្រើនេះគឺជាការប្រើប្រព័ន្ធស៊ីវិលឲ្យហើយជាការប្រើត្រឹមត្រូវហើយអញ្ចឹងសូមឲ្យអង្គជំនុំជម្រះបដិសេធនៅ ខ្ញុំជួបបញ្ហានេះបញ្ហាដែលខ្ញុំទាស់ដោយមេធាវីការពារក្តីនេះទី1អង្គជំរះសូមអគុណចំពោះភាគីពាក់ព័ន្ធដែលបានផ្តល់មតិយោបល់នៅក្នុងការជំទាស់របស់មេធាវីការពារក្តីមិនច្បាស់លាស់គ្មានមូលដ្ឋានដូច្នេះត្រូវច្រានចោលហើយជាកិច្ចបន្តសូមតំណាងសហប្រជាជាតិបន្តកិច្ចតាំងសំណួរទៅដល់អ្នកជំនាញអាជាបន្តទៀតក៏ប៉ុន្តែអង្គជំរះសូមរំលឹកដល់តំណាងសហប្រជាជាតិថាសូមតំណាងសហប្រជាជាតិមានការប្រយ័ត្នប្រយែងនៅក្នុងការតា
certainly take on board the trial chamber's comments. Very specific in the following questions I have for Mr. Chanda. Mr. Chanda, I would like to take you back to the Hungarian journalist. And rather than after you to repeat the story or discuss in detail the story, you mention in your book at page 194, ERN 00192379, the pictures and cassettes and notes of the journalist were confiscated by the Vietnamese Politburo,
although
later returned to
them.
And you give some explanation in your book as to why, after invitation to look at the scene, they may have been confiscated. Can you just help us with that precise point, please?
Sundar Gyori, the Hungarian journalist, he was invited, assisted by officials in Saigon, Ho Chi Minh City, and it was at the initiative of General Chan Van Chau, who was very senior general and of South Vietnamese origin. And clearly, General Chan Van Chau acted on his own initiative. He was outraged by the brutalities, and he wanted the world to know. But the Politburo had a different idea. Politburo did not want to reveal this news without considering the implications of this explosive news going out to the world, because they were looking at Cambodia incident as part of an overall strategic picture involving China, involving other countries, and they wanted to be sure as to how to reveal this information that would be best for Vietnam's strategic interest. And that is why I think that having been given the opportunity to go and see the massacre, his films and cassettes were confiscated by the security people. And it was returned to him only after December 31st, 1977, when the conflict was public, so that Vietnamese had then reason to hold on to that information.
Thank you. Can I turn you to page 196 of your book, which is at ERN 00192381. You've discussed this already. You have a specific question. You talk about after months of planning,
the Vietnamese army launching an important but unpublicized military operation against Cambodia.
In October
1972.
In your expert opinion, can you tell us why such an attack may have not been publicized? Why it had to be unpublicized?
I think the Vietnamese calculation was that an open conflict with Cambodia would inevitably involve other countries
in
response to that kind of attack.
And
so, like the Khmer Rouge have done in the past, they also have attacked without telling anybody that they're attacking. Vietnamese played along, giving the counterpunch, and hoping that they get the lesson and perhaps either negotiate or this defeat would inspire internal rebellion. And that was something that I have heard several times Vietnamese officials say, that this conflict can be resolved either by Pol Pot coming to his senses and changing policy, or people within the party removing
him.
And the third option that was never mentioned to me, but that was the option they had to take,
in order to keep those options open, they had to take this
Can I turn you to page 318 of your book?
ERN 00192503,
in which you discuss how in June 1978, Vietnam began its unpublicized aerial bombing of Cambodia. You describe flying as many as 30 sorties a day. A similar question, why
after war
officially being declared, or at least diplomatic relations settled in December 1978, would the Vietnamese not publicize the aerial bombing that you describe?
Again, not knowing for sure as to what was the calculation, my guess would be that Vietnamese did not want
Vietnam
to, unless the Khmer Rouge themselves publicized the fact that they
are
bombing, and since they did not, the Vietnamese did not see any reason for them to tell the public that they are stepping up the pressure on the Khmer Rouge, because that might again bring protests from other countries, and because this is an expansion of the war, not only on the ground but on the air. So that could have been the reason why they did not publicize the
report.
Can I ask you to comment on the
Khmer
Rouge's
attack on
Cambodia?
Thank you. You were asked by my colleague some questions concerning a Cambodian man by the name of Ross Saroen, R-O-S-S-A-R-O-E-U-N. And you refer to this in page 86 of your book, which is ERN 00192271. And in your the footnotes for that passage, you refer to an interview that you had with him personally on the 14th of January 1981 in Phnom Penh. Can I first ask you to confirm the interview and how it took place, but more particularly how credible you found his story to be, and whether you had or sought any corroboration?
I had met Rasaro during one of my trips and talked about his experience during the Khmer Rouge period. And among many things, he recounted this story. The fact that he himself was raised by a Vietnamese person as an orphan, his wife was Vietnamese. And the account he gave sounded extremely possible. And later on, I found out that 870 was indeed the code name for
Central Committee.
And this is something that someone so simple person would have no way of knowing what would be 870. But he actually saw that later and remembered it was 870. So I had no reason to doubt the accuracy of the story he told me, and it fitted very well with other sources I had about that period.
And
when you wrote your book, Mr. Chanda, were you aware of any confessions made by Vietnamese nationals at S21? I'm asking for the detail, just your knowledge of whether there existed such confessions when you wrote the book.
Yes, I think I knew there were confessions. I had personally seen sheets of paper on my first trip to Tuslang. And there were, of course, I could not read them. I read some which were written in French.
And,
mostly they were in Khmer. But I was told that there were some confessions by Vietnamese.
Can you tell us who told you that?
No, I don't remember. Because at that time there were several people who were looking up the papers in the second floor. I do not recall who told me that.
Do you recall or did you take a note of the dates of any of the confessions?
No, I don't.
Returning to the apparent lulls in the hostility between Cambodia and Vietnam, or certainly a lull in the reporting of any hostility, was there any significant shift in policy between or from the Cambodians or the Vietnamese in that period of 1976 going through 1977?
I think the 76 period was the period when Pol Pot faced some opposition within the party. And again, my recollection is that there were many references to reactionaries, enemies within the party.
And the fact that
Pol Pot decided in 76 to actually withdraw temporarily from Prime Minister's position was kind of seen by experts as an indication of some difficulty he's having inside the party. And also the fact that the name of the party was changed. these indications of internal trouble could perhaps be one reason why the focus was not so much on the border. So kind of the words used were clearly indicative of Vietnam being an enemy.
But that
would be my hunch.
And on the
Vietnamese side, was there any significant shift in policy throughout 1976 through into 77?
76 was an important year for Vietnam because that was the first year after the reunification of the country. They were drawing up their fourth five-year plan and preparing for the Party Congress in December. So in that context, Vietnamese were more preoccupied with the domestic issues. But I would not be surprised if the Vietnamese were aware of the internal opposition Pol Pot was facing. ឬក៏ទំនាស់ផ្ទៃក្នុងរបស់បករបស់ពលពតហើយនេះប្រហែលជាវិធីដែលវៀតណាមចង់បានមានន័យថាចង់ឲ្យពលពតត្រូវបានគេដកចេញពីបាក់
Mr. President, it's half past four. I don't know if we should continue or whether there's a
continuing in the other way. I don't know if we should continue or whether there's a continuing in the other way. I don't know if we should continue or whether there's a continuing in the other way. ទៅអនុរដ្ឋមន្ត្រីគុំខាំងនាំជំរាបចោតទៅកាន់មន្ត្រីគុំខាំងវិញហើយនឹងឲ្យនាំគាត់មកកាន់សាធារណការឲ្យបានមុនម៉ោង 9 ព្រឹកស្អែកជាកំហិតហើយមន្ត្រីតុលាការជួយសម្រួលដល់អ្នកជំនាញដើម្បីឲ្យគាត់បានវិលត្រឡប់ទៅកាន់ទីកន្លែងដែលគាត់ស្នាក់នៅវិញហើយនឹងអញ្ជើញគាត់មកកាន់សាធារណការឲ្យបានមុនម៉ោង 9 ព្រឹកស្អែកហើយលោកនាយកចន្ទណាគឺអរគុណអងយុវៈអរគុណលោកដែលប្រឹងប្រែងនៅក្នុងការចំណាយពេលវេលាដែលមានតម្លៃមកផ្ដល់សក្តិកម្មប៉ុន្តែដោយសារហេតុនៃការភាពជំនាញរបស់លោកមានច្រើនហើយមានការពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងសំណួរផ្សេងៗរបស់ភាគីដែលត្រូវសួរដល់លោកទៀតនោះគឺដំណើរការសម្ដែងការគឺចំណាយពេលមួយថ្ងៃទៀតសម្រាប់ពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងលោករហូតដល់ថ្ងៃរហូតដល់ចប់នៅថ្ងៃស្អែកនេះ
ហើយសង្ឃឹមថាលោកនឹងអញ្ជើញមកតាមការអញ្ជើញនៅថ្ងៃស្អែកទៀតហើយភាគីដូចគ្នាគឺសូមអញ្ជើញចូលរួមក្នុងដំណើរការសម្ដែងការនៅផ្នែកស្អែកឲ្យបានទាន់ម៉ោង 9 ព្រឹក